Hey guys, it's the Infamous from the Infamous Chronicles. I wanted to let you know that all of our shows have partnered up with Civvy's Apparel. Civvy's Apparel is an online clothing store that takes donated military uniforms worn by our men and women in service, and they repurpose them into clothing like t-shirts, tank tops, hoodies, hats for men and women. It's an awesome brand. You guys have seen pictures of us all in the clothing, all over our social media. And what they do that's so special is they donate 10% of all of their sales to local veterans organizations. Now check this out. Go to civviesapparel.com and use our coupon code CHRONICLES20 to save 20% off your entire purchase. That's CHRONICLES20 for 20% off. Go ahead, check them out on their socials at Civvies Apparel or visit them online at civviesapparel.com. Thanks a lot, guys, for helping to support this great cause.
Hey, and welcome back to the Infamous Chronicles. I am the Infamous, your host. And tonight's episode, we sat down with director, writer, creator, Steven Shea. I was joined by the Murder of Nerds compadres, Julio from We Can Be Heroes Comics, and the action figure Junky. We did this episode together, so it's over on their show as well. Steven ended up being a really great guy. He's been a creative influence since he was 16 years old. He's done animation, he's done film, he's done photography, he owns a production company called Abysmal. Really good guy, a lot of fun. We brought him on to talk about his new Ghostbusters animated film and ended up talking about the afterlife and demons in heaven and in hell and our ghost stories, and it was a really fun interview. Great guy. So ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, without further ado, this is our interview with Steven Shea. You're listening to The Infamous Chronicles.
Okay, hi. You're listening to The Infamous Chronicles. Let me down.
Turn down for what?
Do you even know what's going on?
This is The Infamous Chronicles.
The Infamous Chronicles.
You only love me when you want punani.
Wait, what are we doing?
Pardon my French. But you're an asshole!
The infamous Chronicles starts right now.
Hello, thank you for having me. Can't wait.
So we're here to talk about some of the projects you've been working on.
Sure.
And you want to tell us a little bit about what you do?
Yeah, I have a alternative multimedia company called Abysmal Entertainment that next year will be celebrating its 20th year in business. Focus on feature films, commercials, industrials, music videos, do a lot of photography as well as graphics. And this year started focusing more on animation and comics during the lockdown, you know, trying to figure out ways to produce more from home without leaving. So,
And you taught yourself how to do animation during the lockdown.
I did, yeah. At the beginning, you know, everybody was kind of stuck and all of our shoots have been canceled for the year. So I was like, all right, well, I got to do something while sitting around the house, and started watching YouTube tutorials and figuring out how things work. And yeah, started developing some more animated content and then reaching out for more animation clients.
That's awesome, man. I mean, what I did during the pandemic was sleep.
Oh, yeah. That would have been nice.
Yeah, no, but I concentrated on that. But learning animation, that's pretty tough, right? Isn't it?
Yeah, it's gotten easier, I think. I mean, I never learned animation like at a school or anything, right. But there's a lot of YouTube tutorials, and Adobe makes a great software called Adobe Character Animator that I really enjoy, an Adobe Junkie. Yeah. And so they have a lot of tutorials on YouTube where you can go and actually learn the whole software through there. And so started developing that and doing, we developed five different animated series that we're shopping right now.
In a year?
Yeah. In the past.
Dude, I'm telling you, when I was telling you about this guy, this guy's a doer. I mean, he sets out his mind to do something and he's doing it. Like, I've known you since we opened the shop.
Mm-hmm.
And he's always working on something and he's getting it done. Like, I saw some of your animation. I saw Shark Baby.
Oh, yeah.
And you got some awards for that.
That was so we started doing some of the Adobe Character Animator is great because it uses a live webcam feed. Mm-hmm. So you can actually, it does facial tracking recognition, so you can act out your stuff, and once you model all your characters, they act the same way you do in real time.
Yeah.
Which is great. So we got some of that stuff going, but then I wanted to have an animation portfolio, and so I wanted to start doing some more frame by frame animation, but unfortunately I'm a really shitty artist. So I'm a really good photographer though, so I did a photo shoot with an actress friend acting out all the scenes in photographs, just shooting like 20 frames a second, right. 16 frames a second. And then I took all those photographs and then traced every single one. Spent about 4 months tracing every single one just to have a more traditional style of animation.
And that's for Shark Baby.
And that was Shark Baby.
Yeah.
And so it took like...
I love that song.
It's... Yeah, they ripped us off, I think. But hopefully I don't get sued.
Well, can you tell us a little bit about what Shark Baby is? Because you're just going to blow your mind.
Okay. So Shark Baby, basically we... You know, I'm not a huge fan of film festivals. Film festivals is a whole ordeal. And there's a lot of caliber of movies that play film festivals that are like very highbrow, very artistic, and never make any sense.
Bougie and boring.
Exactly. Like, not a fan.
I live for it, man. That's the kind of stuff I want to make.
No, it is.
Like Oscar shit?
No. That's a damn lie.
So basically, I went to a festival. I had a documentary play some festivals last year. And so I saw a bunch of these movies. And I'm just like, oh, my gosh. Like, I want to make, like, a spoof of these art house films.
Oh.
So Shark Baby was literally this idea that stemmed from that, where it's a woman wakes up on a beach, sees a shark swimming in the ocean that breaches out of the water, immediately has a strange connection, becomes impregnated, and then gives birth to a shark.
Oh, my God.
And I spent 4 months drawing this stupid thing, and it's 2 minutes long, but it's, we got to, Dia Frampton is the lead actress in it. She was the runner-up on American Idol, or The Voice, sorry, The Voice. She
does.
Wow. And she had a band called Megan Dia that's very popular.
Did it win the Palme d'Or?
It's nominated, I hear.
Sweet. But,
jokes on them. And then the shark is played by Dana Snyder, who's a big voice actor at Adult Swim. He plays Master Shake on Aqua Teen Hunger Force.
That's so awesome.
And so he's the baby shark.
Dude, when I saw it, and you didn't tell me anything about like this was supposed to be like a spoof of that. But I got that. Like, as soon as you watch it, you're like, oh my God, dude, you're just basically fuck you and these things. It's hilarious and it's weird. I showed it to my wife and she was like, did she just fuck a shark? Yeah, I think so. I think that's what's
mentally.
Yes.
It was like mental intercourse.
Yeah.
You guys remember that fake trailer in Tropic Thunder that Robert Downey Jr.'s character was in with Tobey Maguire, and it's supposed to be...
Where he's Australian?
Where he is the priest, the two priests.
Yeah.
Oh, they're in love with each other.
And they're in love with each other, and it's got the music, and it's supposed to give you the idea that it's some kind of crazy, serious Oscar bait movie.
Yep.
You get the tone from just that two-minute trailer. Is that kind
exactly.
of...
Exactly, nice. Yeah. I mean, the whole short's in black and white. There's French subtitles.
Oh, yes.
So good.
It's ridiculous. Yeah. It's
what
ridiculous.
About, like, more... Are you interested at all in some of the modern film festivals, like South by Southwest or anything like that?
Yeah, I mean, it's... I think there's a lot of filmmakers that come up with, like, okay, I'm going to make a movie, and I'm going to play Sundance, and I'm going to win an award, and I'm going to have a big career. And it's like, it doesn't really work that way. But it's just... I've never been, like, a hoity-toity... type filmmaker. Like, I want to be a commercial filmmaker. I want to be more the Michael Bay than the...
You said Michael Bay. That's scary.
That's scary. That's
scary. Well, he's saying it in
I want to be more like... I would rather make Transformers than make Nomadland.
I immediately started spinning around you with a camera in my head.
And yes, explosion exactly. in the background.
Yeah.
Nomadland was so boring.
I didn't... I missed
Nomadland?
It.
Ugh. Oh, we were talking about this. That's the
movie that won Best Picture this year.
I love her. I think she's an amazing actress.
And she was amazing in it.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. I mean, she literally lived in that van for the whole shoot.
Yeah.
And no makeup. And she's naked and did not go to the gym beforehand. Like, she, as a woman, you don't really take risks like that in Hollywood. Because you have to be perfect and beautiful all the time.
No, she's great.
So she was incredible. She deserved the Oscar. But the movie is literally about nothing. It's so boring.
I liked it, but I like those little slice of life independent movies. But
you liked it because we've been to Wild Drug.
That's right. That's right.
Wild
I was telling
Drug.
Huge.
We didn't go.
Store,
I don't think we went to that one though, right?
Or no, there's only one.
Oh, okay. Then that was funny.
It's like a store the size of a mall.
Yeah.
And each little room is like a little dumb Midwest nook for, like, you know, one room is taffy and one room is guns and one room is boots and. But it's fucking huge. You could be there all day and not go through it.
Yeah.
And we took them on the way back, but it was at the very beginning of COVID when we went to South Dakota. Yeah. And we were there for like maybe 5 minutes and all of us were kind of like,
let's get out of here.
Get us the fuck out of here. No one's in masks. It was like when everything was extra scary. But she's works there in the movie and it's like, what a weird, of all the things to put in a movie, this rundown ass little.
But to your point, it's like, it's a good movie. I'm not sure if it's Best Picture Oscar, but it's a good movie. However, I'm one and done. I'm good.
Right.
But The Rock, if we ended this show and went and watched The Rock right now, who here wouldn't be happy?
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Sign me up. Yep.
Oh,
I get,
no.
So I get where you're coming from. It's
not The Rock, the actor.
No, you're talking about The Rock with like,
welcome to The Rock.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
With Nicholas Cage.
Jimi Hendrix's guitar.
Back when Nicholas Cage was a good actor.
Was he?
I think he's gotten better, to be honest.
Yeah, yeah. Did you see Mandy? Have you seen Mandy?
No, but I did watch the one with the mannequins, or the Chuck E. Cheese one, and it was
the Five Nights,
cool.
Five Nights at Freddy's. That wasn't, yeah. Five Nights at Freddy's.
But no, he doesn't talk.
Oh. Huh?
So it made it even better. He's fucking crazy.
So we're swearing off festivals.
Well, I mean, people can go to festivals. I just personally, I've never been a big fan.
Yeah.
And I mean, there's so many that are scams, because it's easy for someone to say, oh, I can rent a theater for a couple days and charge people $50 to submit their films and then give them a piece of paper at the end so they won something.
Dude, we should totally do that.
Oh, wait, hold on. There's a drag race outside.
What? I thought you said we didn't get drag races out here.
I kept the garage door open for you guys so I didn't kill you. You want me to close it?
Okay, Toretto. It's all good.
Yeah. I live my life for 1 mile at a time.
Quarter mile.
Quarter mile. Quarter.
Yeah. Technically, that was a motorcycle and he really wasn't revving.
Oh, okay. All right, so okay,
but
now the thing about we were talking about was your animation.
Yes,
and 2 days ago, was it 2 days ago?
Well, technically
3 days.
The 15th of June.
Yeah. When the audience 15th. Will hear this, it will be
June 15th. Which you released something really special. I thought it was great, and I want you to be able to tell people what it was because they need to go and check this out. It's really cool. And you announced it. On June 8th,
yes. Which, yes, June 8th is the national federally instated holiday,
yes.
Of Ghostbusters Day.
Goddamn right. Represent.
Yep.
Right,
represent.
Right. Exactly.
Because that's when Ghostbusters was released.
Awesome.
Originally.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So we what we did, another thing we did during the pandemic is I'm a huge Ghostbusters fan. I have a lot of friends that are hardcore Ghostbuster fans.
Oh, yeah.
You have one more.
Yeah. Yep,
there we go.
For life.
And so we came up with the idea, just because we could, now that we knew about animation, we're trying to build a bigger footprint with animation, of making the very first, come to find out, animated Ghostbusters fan film.
Wow.
Because nobody had ever made one that was specifically... There's a lot of fan films that, right. Have been made, but no one ever animated one.
That's crazy. You would think somebody would have done it. And
well, I think for a long time, animation lived in a space where most people didn't have access to it.
Sure.
I mean, could you imagine cell drawing a cartoon? You know, and not everyone... He had a year to learn the program.
It was a nightmare doing it. So,
right.
Could you have done it without COVID?
No, absolutely not.
I mean, you got to really...
Well, and I have friends, too, that are like bigger animators that I've talked to, and they're just like, you're psychotic. Like, there's no way any of us would ever do that. That's crazy. And it's like, well, I was hoping someone would be like, you're crazy. We're going to give you a job because you did this crazy thing.
Weird things have happened.
Right? Yeah. But we came up with the idea to make our own Ghostbusters fan film.
And it's called...
It's called Ghostbusters Reanimated. It's on YouTube now. It's fully accessible. We dropped the trailer on Ghostbusters Day, thinking that there was going to be a huge onslaught of content coming out for Afterlife, for the new movie, which there really wasn't.
No, I was very surprised about
it's
that.
It's not coming out until November. And...
Yep.
Yeah, but it's Ghostbusters Day. You know, I was hoping for more than a couple. You said a few t-shirts came out.
They did four exclusive t-shirts that are only available this month. And a couple toys got announced, and they had a Q&A with the cast.
Oh, cool.
And they released some pictures, and they introduced two of the new characters.
Oh, all right.
But no new... they haven't dropped a trailer for it in over a year
and a half.
Yeah,
it desperately needs a new one.
Yeah,
needs a new one.
They'll get one. They'll get one. What are we in? This is June, so that's 5 months away. Oh, yeah. I'm sure there'll be another one. Probably in August.
So did you guys get a chance to watch the fan film?
I did.
We did.
Yep.
And what did you guys think?
It was fun.
I thought it was cool. I mean, I thought, I admittedly watched it from two angles, which I do all movies.
Mm-hmm. One on his head and one through his legs.
One, I always watch a movie where I'm like, oh.
Upright dog.
Like Michael Bay, I'm like, I'll count his shots. Usually for the first 5 minutes, I'm like, one, two, three, one, one, two, three, one, one, two, three. Because Michael Bay has a 3-second shot.
Sure.
And I'll look for stuff like that, or continuity errors, or, you know, creative camera angles. Like in The Final Girls, you know, those weird, like when the ceiling starts dripping and stuff. And then it'll take me out of enjoying the movie and it'll make me focus, because I'm also a creative person and I do design and marketing. So when I watched your movie, the first time I watched it, I watched it with a more critique on the animation style and how did he get this to come together. And how did he do the music? And is the voice matched up with the lips? And I really thought from a technical standpoint, it was very impressive.
Being you sounds exhausting.
Yeah, dude, you're no fun to go to the movies with.
Yeah.
No, that's not true.
No, but he doesn't say this shit out loud.
Yeah, I don't ever say this out loud.
No, it's all in his head.
I just process it that way.
All right.
And then, you know, I watch it again with all that turned off. And I agree with Sean. It was really fun. It was super original. And I liked how they were, like, debating the existence of Ghostbusters in general. Because I know that in Afterlife, it's about a world where the Ghostbusters did exist.
Right.
But to see it, like, where this I interpret it as, like, college-age kids or young 20-something kid talking about taking on their own science experiment and, you know, being fans of Ghostbusters. But it wasn't saying that it was real, you know?
Right.
I thought that was such a cool, clever
twist.
I took
it as that they were saying the Ghostbusters were real, but were the ghosts real? It was kind
of... Yeah, it was kind of like a...
They existed. They were dudes. But what was their... was what they were doing
like authentic?
Right.
Authentic.
Right.
Yeah.
I thought it was funny too that you like made fun of yourself as a Ghostbusters fan when he's like arguing about how the science is real. And
oh, yeah.
No one's ever proven that.
Yeah.
I thought that was really clever.
Yeah. It's, and that whole idea is kind of taken from Ghostbusters 2, which starts with them being like, my dad says these guys are full of crap.
Right.
And some people have a hard time believing the paranormal. No, he just says you're full of crap. And that's why you went out of business.
Yep, exactly. So a couple years later, people still didn't believe it.
Because if you weren't there, would you have believed it? Would you have believed that a 100-foot marshmallow man walked through the New York City in a time before cell phone cameras?
That's the thing. Absolutely. People, I mean, now you believe pretty much anything as long as you capture it.
Yeah.
Well, like the government just dropped all the UFO information. Exactly. Right? People are still like,
Yeah, I know. People are still like, meh, whatever. I still don't think
so. Like on film.
Yeah.
And they're like, damn, it's fake.
Yeah.
Or like flat earthers, you know, as a whole.
Yeah, yeah. We should do a show on those assholes.
Oh, yep. Dude.
We should invite a bunch in and then like take it really seriously.
Yeah.
What I learned about flat earthers.
Like, Julio and I are flat earthers, of course, because we're smart. But Sean over here is a fucking moron.
Yeah, so try to educate
the world around.
Try to educate this idiot on how the earth is really flat. And I would pretend to be really excited and involved, and I can fake that and ask the dumbest questions and sound sincere.
Wait, what? That's you amazing. Can't see a boat, so the world's flat?
Get out of here.
Get the fuck out of here.
Yep.
I always thought it was because of the curvature of the earth.
Well, you know, the funny thing about it is I learned a lot about flat earthers during the pandemic because I would just listen to podcast after podcast.
Yeah.
And
you get down some slippery slopes.
Right. And exactly.
Home. Like this show, for example. Yeah.
True. That's how I discovered it, and I asked for a job. I learned that the flat earthers aren't all people that believe that the earth isn't round. There are flat earthers that believe it's round. They just don't believe in the science, the numbers, that the distance between here and the moon and the sun and that we're on an axis and all that shit, all the details. They don't believe that. But they lump themselves in with the flat earthers.
It's easy to discount that science.
Yeah.
It's really, it's not necessarily proof. Oh, wait. It is.
Oh, wait. There's an international space station taking pictures of the round Earth right now.
Exactly.
That's not real. That was filmed by Martin Scorsese.
No.
Are they really just trolling us?
Who?
These flat Earth fucktards?
No, man.
They're hardcore.
Assholes.
That's what's so interesting.
I couldn't hang out with one.
That, like, a lot of these guys that are talking, they sound really highly educated. And they have great arguments that don't make any sense.
You almost believe it.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Where you're like, or like the people that go into like the 9/11 stuff.
Yeah.
And they're like, this wall was reinforced and this building can't blow up this way. And you're just watching it. You're like, fuck, man. Those are some good points. But no, I'm not going to go.
Or the one that blows my mind is that the family of the people that actually run the one of the towers, they were on vacation during that time.
Dun, dun, dun. Okay, would you rather hang out for an hour with a flat earther or a dude who wears a baseball cap with a flat bill and the label still on it? Ugh. You have to hang out for 1 hour.
Fuck, what do you mean, hang out with myself? I do it all the time.
Oh, God.
A flat earther or a brony?
He's fired.
Oh.
Flat earther.
Yeah, I'm totally taking them out for pizza.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're probably more fun to make fun of, and they wouldn't even get it.
Now, I have a question for you, Steven.
Yeah.
As a huge Ghostbuster fan, where do you stand on the actual paranormal?
Oh, good question.
I have had some experiences
definitely
have led me to believe that there is existence of paranormal activity, for sure.
Do you believe in the afterlife?
I do. I don't know if I believe in it as like a from a Jesus standpoint or what exactly I believe. And I was raised, I went to a Christian school from kindergarten through 11th grade.
So you had the proper education.
And then raised Catholic while doing that.
Wow. I'm sorry.
So
a quick way not to believe in God.
Yeah.
Well, it was interesting, though, because you become highly educated at that point.
Absolutely.
You read the Bible a dozen times. And so then you start asking questions like, well, why is this so conflicting?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What does God say? Smite your enemy, but then, or he says eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, but then he says turn the other cheek. Right. I'm kind of confused.
Well, that's Old Testament, New Testament.
Yeah, and they're like, well, we don't follow the Old Testament. Like, the Ten Commandments are in the Old Testament. Yeah, like, so, well,
is the anti-gay movement that you're so hard on about. It's in the Old Testament. So
why are you so anti-gay, Julio? Jesus.
What?
Julio, we can be heroes. It's so anti-gay.
Like, the least anti-gay people I've ever met.
I love the gays, dude. Just, best time.
Julio's like one of my only friends that'll go to a gay bar with me.
Yeah.
Oh, totally. And then here's the other one, because that's fun.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, my God. Best time.
I'm no kidding. Yes, it is.
And you drink for free.
Oh, yes.
If you look like you, you do.
Yeah. Thank you. Yes. No, dude, white party, Palm Springs. Anytime you guys want to go. Me and Winnie did it like 3 or 4 times.
I've done it. It's a blast.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I just stay away from cranberry juice, and I'm good.
But back to my question.
I don't understand that. Because we're wearing white?
Yes. Oh, I thought you meant it's all white people party.
No,
it's unless that's what you meant.
It's all white clothing.
It's all white clothing. Yeah, no cranberry juice.
So the reason I asked you that is because Sean and I watched Conjuring the other night.
Okay.
And
the
one? Yeah, the new one.
Yep.
And I know Sean's not an atheist and he's not a Christian. He just challenges the construct of organized religion.
Sure.
But so I was asking him, because I know that he believes in ghosts, and I was like, is it hard for you to believe that there's demons but not believe that there's God? And I find that fascinating. Mm. And we're friends, so it's not an offensive question. It was genuine curiosity. Yeah. And he was kind of like, oh yeah, that's
you.
Yeah,
I mean, if you have one, you have to have the other. So
tough.
Devil is real.
Evil and devil and demon and the devil and I'm not so sure I would. So I believe in evil and I believe in demons. A construct as black and white and as simple as God or the devil is a little harder for me to swallow.
Mm.
There's levels of gray.
Accept the bad and not accept the good, like you do, like as human beings are.
Right. I mean, you have a yin, you have a yang, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can't if you think that there are evil spirits, then you have to accept that there must be
an opposite.
Yeah. I mean, and they just don't like the attention. They fly under the radar. Angels, they don't need all that hauntings and possessions and shit, because that doesn't serve any purpose for them.
Well, and I have to admit too, like I firmly believe in the existence of a life in a form that is not tangible. However,
ghosts, you mean ghosts?
Yeah. Okay. But I have personally had very real paranormal experiences in my old house that my grandparents lived in.
Mm-hmm.
And all of my experiences were, at first, obviously fucking terrifying, but they all ended up being positive experiences. And my daughter, who's 8 now, was 5, 4?
Yeah.
And she was able to tell me things about my grandfather who she had never met.
Wow.
And so
that's creepy as shit.
It was. Mm-hmm. I never told you this story.
Yeah, no, you have.
Oh yeah,
I'm just acting interested because we're on the show.
Yeah, so cliff notes for you, Steven, because I've told it on the show before. Is my grandparents lived there. We moved in. My grandma passed away, and shortly after we moved in, some weird like light on and off stuff was happening, and my daughter became very afraid of the back room near the bathroom. She wouldn't go down the hall by herself, and one day I just saw her staring into the room, just petrified white. Super scared. Fast forward a couple of days go by. I tell my wife this story. She's kind of like, okay, sure. And I come out and she's underneath the table talking to someone.
Mm.
Wow.
And I was like, I called my wife. I was like, you need to get the fuck home.
Yep.
Right now.
Yeah. Don't leave me alone with this.
Yeah. So we sit her down and, you know, it's one of those moments. And I'm like, okay, I don't want to scare her. And then she goes like, Jack says, hi, daddy. That's my grandpa's name.
Oh.
So then it was like, oh, this isn't bad. And my mom comes over and she was like super skeptical about the whole thing.
Sure.
So she's sitting on the counter and she's like, so many infamous, like, did you see that? Do you recognize anyone in this picture? She held up a family picture and Minnie Infamous goes, yeah, that's Grandpa Jack, who she's never met.
Wow.
Pointed right to him and she's like, yeah, he's at the table right now. It was a trip. So my experiences have all been
positive.
And so it's hard. I think I struggle with, like, when you watch the Conjurings of the world and the Ghostbusters and stuff, it's like, I've never had an evil experience like that.
Right.
I don't personally know anyone that's had an evil experience. My next question is going to be what your experience was.
Sure.
So, but then I run into the yin and the yang question, but I'm on the opposite side. I experienced a positive afterlife experience.
I had negative.
Yeah, you had a bad one.
At his house.
At my house, too. He saw ghosts in my backyard.
Yeah.
Or a presence. He felt a presence.
I felt a presence as clearly as I feel all of you here one time. We make this story short because I'd love to hear yours, but we had what's called a sound bath here a couple years back.
Oh, okay.
Do you know what those are?
Yeah, I do.
Oh, okay.
Have you done it? I haven't, but we've talked about it.
They're very interesting. Right. And if you get into it, I'll make this short for the audience, but all two of them. But if you get into it, you can, you know, kind of get your senses taken to another level. And
like,
I would see
like meditation.
Sure. Yeah.
Like acid.
There you go. Yeah.
Like acid.
Yeah. Yeah. Or like some type of hallucinogen. Anyway, my senses got taken to another level and I felt a presence in his house as clearly as I feel all of you here. And as soon as it was over, I got the fuck up, got my keys, and bounced. I didn't tell anyone because it was frightening.
You should have seen him. He stood straight up, was staring out the back door, and almost backed out of the house. He didn't say anything to anybody. He was just gone. And I thought he had to poop.
And I had
Don't you have it like video? Like on
home? I used to because we have a security system, but we don't have anymore. But he doesn't like pooing in other people's houses. So I'm like, oh, he went home to poo. You know?
FYI.
I called him and he didn't pick up and he didn't tell me till the next day what happened.
Wow. And I hadn't heard any of the stories about his daughter at that point.
Sure.
I didn't even know anything about that. I mean, we weren't that close yet. And then I told him and he was like, oh, well, there's a story behind that. So now we know. Wow. And I was just frightened because I didn't know how to take it. But in the house I originally lived in for birth to six, I had a piece of shit bully ghost that would fuck with me constantly.
Ugh.
Dickhead. Hope he's rotting in hell.
Oh, man.
Fuck him.
Probably.
That's probably how that math works.
Yeah. He's an asshole.
So what was your experience, dude?
So I actually had two experiences that were similar, but at completely different times.
Okay.
They were both on deathbeds.
What?
And they were both on deathbeds. When my father passed away, he had cancer. And that was a little over 10 years ago. And we were in the hospital with him. He couldn't breathe or he couldn't speak. It spread to his brain. And he was like barely hanging in there. We knew we only had a day or so.
Whoa.
And we'd be sitting there like holding his hand and talking to him. And then all of a sudden one day we were doing that. And he just suddenly jerks and looks at the corner of the room. Starts like hyperventilating, pointing at the corner and freaking out, like not like that there's something in the corner of the room. And we're looking around like we don't know what's going on. Like he's going crazy, like pointing at this thing. Super creepy. And so I didn't sleep well that night. And then a couple years.
Shoot.
So a similar experience a couple years later, my grandmother, my mom's mom, is slowly passing away from cancer as well, but she is completely
lucid,
normal.
Yeah,
like she can talk, she's just hanging out in her apartment. They're just hospices there helping out, and my mom was there with her. And then one night she starts screaming in the middle of the night, woke my mom up. My mom ran in there and she was pointing to the corner saying, "What are you doing here? Why are you here? No, I don't want to go. No, why are what are you doing here? What are you doing here?" And she passed away 2 minutes later.
Wow.
So
like, as somebody that was educated as a Christian, is there a part of you that like comes goosebumps to the conclusion that it was like,
like there was someone there to take you, you know,
like the ferryman or the.
One of two things. It's either some kind of. I mean, I've heard there's two theories, and you can believe whatever you want, but it's either some kind of chemical is released in the brain that makes you see things that aren't there, or straight up angel of death, some form or another. It sounds like nothing that is too welcoming, because I've heard similar stories where they're like, where people have had similar experiences, but thought, but said things like, oh, okay, is it time? All right. Because maybe they were seeing a loved one who would come to get him. Right. It doesn't necessarily sound like it was that in either case.
And my mom is a very religious person and doesn't believe in ghosts or anything like that. And she has changed her tune since then. And she, I think she had made a comment where she thought that it could have been a loved one.
You would hope, right?
But my mom turned hysterical when all this was happening.
Because
it was like,
It could have even, it could have even been one of her parents. Right. But at that time, you now realize
it's time.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
And there's
that's it.
That's it. It's like, Who knows how any of us would react?
You guys ever see that movie Martyrs, the original one?
The French.
Yeah, the French one, yeah. Right? That you guys got to watch it, but it's pretty messed up. And basically, they kind of figure out in that movie that women, like, you torture them and they get to the point where they're going to die. They hang on longer than men do. And they can see just the moment before afterlife starts.
That sounds horrible.
Yes. It's a horrible. It's an intense movie.
How do you
put
that into practice? Like, how do you find that out?
Well, you got it. And then, like, you see at the end of the end of the movie, the girl that's been tortured all to the point of near death is telling this lady, right, something. She's whispering in her ear, and then the lady gets the information, and the girl dies, and the lady goes in the bathroom and shoots herself. Mm. Remember?
Yeah.
Like, this movie, dude, is messed up. But people love this movie. People love this movie. You're I personally like did you. Not. I did not like the movie.
The movie, the American, not that they re, well, I think they did
remake
American,
it. Yeah.
But the American one that's similar to that is Flatliners.
Remember Flatliners? Yeah.
Flatliners is legit, dude.
That was more happy.
I fucking love Flatliners.
Yeah.
My wife always makes fun of me. Why do you like this movie?
Because Kiefer's in it.
It's fucking great.
Cool. Yeah.
Every actor in it is amazing, and it's got so much cool colored lighting.
Julia Roberts is in it.
Julia Roberts. Yeah, it's had a big cast.
Is Kevin Bacon in it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep.
Joel Schumacher. Early Joel Schumacher.
Lost Boys, man.
Before he sucked.
No. Did you ever see Blood Creek by Joel Schumacher? It's like his Nazi vampire movie. That's like one of the last ones that he made.
No,
it's really cool. I was very surprised by it. Anyway, it's on Netflix.
But what's interesting about all this, though, talking about do you believe in the afterlife, is it's like I like the idea that there would be an afterlife because dying is like one of the, it's like, at least personally for me, is like one of the biggest fears. I've had a lot of people die over the years in the family and whatnot, and so it's like I'm terrified of death.
Yeah.
So the idea that there is something after death is comforting, whether it's real or not. The idea of it's comforting.
What scares you more, dying or the knowledge that you no longer exist?
Oh God. I think dying. I think dying to me is one of those things where you have a lot of goals in life,
right?
And it's like I don't want to die before I complete some of these goals.
That's exactly what I was going to say. It's very important,
you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's been, especially like having a parent die and my wife's mother died the same year and my stepbrother died the same year. It was like a weird, it was a big year to kind of light a fire under your ass, being like, hey, look, like we're all.
Time is limited.
Totally. Yeah. Which is why I do a lot of things.
Right.
Sounds like it. I mean, there's all kinds of goals. I'd love to see my daughter get married.
Yeah.
And plus, I have this Iron Man coming from eBay, and I'd like to see it. I'd like to see him before I die.
I do like the order you put that in.
Yeah. Exactly.
Wow. I could really have seen that sentence going either way.
I mean, it's a toss-up on any given day.
Oh, man. So what, you're animating, but that's new, and you're in more of the film side. If you could design your career trajectory now, where would you go?
I mean, right now, personally, I'm working toward being a writer director for hire.
Okay.
I have a manager. I have a lot of open doors at different studios that we've been shopping different stuff through. That's been going really well. I just moved to LA 5 years ago, over 5 years ago. So I'm still fairly new here.
Where did you come from?
From Florida. I lived in Orlando for 15 years. And we had a fantastic film community in Orlando. We had a great film incentive program. We were doing back-to-back movies and television. But, you know, you get one new governor and they change that. And then all of a sudden the industry just disappears overnight.
Wow.
A lot of it went to Atlanta, right?
It did.
Yeah.
And then New Orleans, you know, Louisiana was a big spot and North Carolina was a big hot spot. And all three of the states lost their incentive the same year, which is raised a lot of other conspiracy theories on how Georgia got funneled everything.
And they're
the only unlimited incentive in the country. So now every studio can go there and shoot as much as they want.
There's always a peach at the end of everything I like.
Totally.
Yep.
That peach symbol, right?
Wow.
Everything Marvel.
Yep. They shoot all the Marvel stuff there. They're shooting Black Panther 2 there right now.
They say that
that's Wakanda is located in Atlanta,
Georgia.
Atlanta, Georgia.
It's where The Walking Dead are.
So is
where The Walking Dead is.
So is Avatar.
Pandora all there. And Wakanda is in Georgia.
Mind blown.
But they say that the incentives are so good on the movies that regardless of the budget, it's enough to cover the entire cast salary.
It's up to 35%.
Yep.
Wow. Nice.
Up to 35. And that's on, if you spend $100 million, that's $35 million.
That's your entire marketing budget right there paid for.
Shit. Yep.
So, I mean, I get it. Totally. I mean, Canada right now, you know, that's been the oldest incentivized you know, since the X-Files.
X-Files.
Right. Yeah, and I had two friends that are up there right now that just went up for movies.
Vancouver and Toronto, man.
Yep. Blowing up.
But. So what inspired you to make to become a filmmaker? Was there like one moment?
So it's funny, everybody has like that movie that they watch, like their Star Wars, right? It's like, I saw Star Wars and I wanted to be a filmmaker. No, I never saw Star Wars as a kid.
Oh.
That
explains a lot.
I didn't, yeah.
Sean choked on your statement there.
What?
I never, as a kid, I never.
I heard what he said. That's when you're fucking supposed to have seen it. What?
Yeah, I didn't. For whatever reason, I never was into, like, never saw Star Wars, but I was into horror movies, like slasher movies.
Okay,
yeah,
you've redeemed yourself.
Yes, yeah, so I was raised on 80s slasher movies.
He also loves
Maniac. Did you love Maniac?
Maniac is great.
It's great. Love Maniac.
And so, yeah, I mean, all of that style. So my movie that actually turned me into a filmmaker was Scream.
Yeah.
When Scream
was
came
so
out.
Meta.
And it was like, it really pulled back the curtain to kind of make, like, I grew up on an island in South Florida. So, like, we didn't have, I had to drive 2 hours to the nearest first run movie theater to see a new movie.
Are you
so
shitting
it was like,
me?
No, it's serious. Like when
it's
I was
like going to
school,
San Diego to watch a movie.
Yeah. I'd have to drive up to Miami to go see.
Oh my god.
To go see something. So I would go up and watch three movies in a row. Like
right, yeah.
You know, when I
make a weekend out of it
because it was like I couldn't see anything.
Did you at least have a Blockbuster on your
island? It was funny. I managed a Blockbuster.
Me too.
when I was 17, 17,
I worked that one.
But we managed one.
I never got there. They wouldn't let me do it.
That's because you're brown.
Well, it was funny. I was
banging the employees. That was my problem.
I was 17, so I legally wasn't allowed to be a manager. Oh. But they're basically like, well, you're like the assistant manager, but technically you need to be the manager. But we're going to pay you and deem you an assistant manager because legally you can't be a manager. It was a whole thing. But I saw Scream, and that really made me realize there's more to movies than just, you know, fun. And I mean, you didn't have as much behind the scenes stuff back then either. You didn't have Blu-rays or DVDs yet.
No.
So you'd have to watch some like HBO special to see a behind the scenes.
Loved
or
those.
Entertainment Tonight, you know, would show some
I
clips.
Tuned in every night to Entertainment.
Yeah. Yep.
Yes.
Yeah. So you never got to really see that stuff. And so I was also on an island, so I was highly limited on what I could do. Mm-hmm. So I got a job in Key West at the TV station. And so I started running cameras at 16 and doing commercial switching, editing deck to deck. At the time, this is in 1997. And got a job at Blockbuster because I wanted to, you know, just get involved as much as possible. And then I started working with the film commission.
Free rentals.
Totally. And the posters. And posters alone.
Posters.
And you got them before they came out.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
You got them on Friday and they came out on Tuesday.
Right? Well, and back then, VHS cost $80 a piece.
Yeah, to buy them.
Yep.
Yeah.
Because you couldn't get them, like, in stores yet.
Yeah.
But I did get a job with the Florida Film Commission and for the keys. And so the craziest thing is the very first movie set I was ever on was True Lies.
Whoa.
The scene,
I was on the day of the bridge where they blew up the bridge and the Harrier jets land and everything. Yes. I was on set that day.
That is cinema gold.
Yeah. Yes. And exactly. So then I was like, oh, I want to do this forever, thinking that every movie set was going to be that. I hate to tell you, it was not.
As a new LA native, the remember the glass elevator? In True Lies, where he runs the horse into it.
Oh, yeah.
That's the Bonaventure in L.A.
Yes.
Oh. Yeah.
And you can go ride that glass elevator, and there's a plaque on it. It's actually a really cool building.
Funny.
Architecturally speaking, it's really neat.
Yeah, I had my prom there. We called it the Bonaventure.
Smooth. That's cool, though. True Lies is a good one to get started on screen.
Hell yeah.
You've chosen some good ones so far. Yeah.
So then I went to college in Orlando, and I was the weird outcast horror kid, you know, so I couldn't get into film school. Like, all my friends got in. I couldn't get in. So I was like, all right, well, screw you. And I went and spent the rest of my college fun on my first feature.
Oh.
And so I made a feature by the time I was 23, and then I got distribution on it, like full international distribution. And so I had a movie in Best Buy before my friends had even graduated.
There you go.
And
now you got to say the name of the movie, man.
Oh God, it's called The Night Owl. It's terrible. Don't find it. You won't be able to find it.
I
think.
But Best Buy.
Yeah.
So good on you.
No. It's that's awesome. I mean, it was a lot easier back then because you could make a $2,000 horror film and get in Hollywood Video. Nowadays it's a lot. Nobody cares nowadays. Like, physical media is not nearly as important as it was back then. But
yeah, you go on to like Vudu, and the first 20 movies are all a bunch of shit you've never heard of.
Yep.
And you're like, but I know how you feel. I wrote 2 books. And to go to Barnes & Noble, and I'm like, because there was those kiosks, right? And I'm like, hi, I'm looking for a book. The author is Jeremy P. Elder. They look it up. They take me over to it. I know where the fuck it is.
Right. Yeah.
And it just felt cool.
Got to go through it. Yeah.
So douchey.
You would have done the same damn thing.
Oh my God. I would have brought every member of my family with me.
That's insane. It was cool. I'm in a store.
Well, I remember calling my dad, who was like very critical of everything, you know, and I was like, oh yeah, the movie came out today. You can go get it at Best Buy. And he's like, what are you talking about? I'm like, no, it's in, like, you can go get it. And he calls me back an hour later. He's like, you're not going to believe this. Your movie's in Best Buy. And I'm like, I told you. Like, literally, we put the movie, you know.
It's really cute that he went and checked, though.
That's like, I bought all the copies. I'm like, well, now nobody else can get
a
copy.
That's cool. Exactly. That's really cool.
My dad would have been like, what's a movie? Yeah. I'm not interested.
No. Like, my parents did the same thing. I was like, oh, I got a pitch meeting today. And they're like, oh, that's good, honey.
Yeah.
Good luck with that. Yeah. Way to go. Yeah. Very soon.
I'll remember your excitement when I'm rich, Mom.
Yeah, exactly. And then I got the opposite effect when I got one with from my wife. She's like, oh, so we can move now.
Third what? Story coming what? In.
There's no money. There's just me talking an idea out. Yeah, she was ready to move last week because I'm gone.
I'm getting a Lexus with your next movie, bitch.
It's funny how driven and creative all four of us are in very different ways. Sean does photography.
And you know, masturbation.
You write. You do videography and editing
and writing.
And writing.
And drawing.
And I do podcasts and writing. And it's so cool how right here we can make a fucking movie with the four of us and all of our strengths could apply.
Oh, yeah.
It's just,
yeah.
Hell yeah.
That's one of the only really cool things about living in LA.
Yeah.
Everybody you talk to can be valuable to you and you can be valuable to them.
For sure.
If you just spend a couple extra seconds peeling back that first fake layer about the weather in your job and really getting to know them. You know, that's how Julio ended up on this show. I was a customer of his comic book store.
Yeah,
nice.
And now here we are.
And so that's how I met Julio, too.
Yeah. I'm amazing.
You need to stop sleeping with your customers, bro.
I got to
stop. Service is so nice.
Yes. Nasty habit.
When they run up a bill that's too high, there's ways that he makes them pay it off.
Oh. Hashtag me too at the comic book store. You know, I had an idea that I was actually brainstorming one time, and I said I wanted to make a movie called Hashtag. And they're like, why? Oh, it's about, you know, a horror movie about the Me Too movement. And they were like, no.
Yeah. No.
We can't make that movie.
No, it's going to be, like, funny. And like, no.
Who said no?
No. A couple people.
wasn't anybody here.
No, but maybe we should work on that.
They made a movie called Hashtag Horror.
Really?
That was, like, the hashtag symbol horror that came out a couple years ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I saw that movie somewhere. I didn't see it, but I saw.
Same.
Yeah.
Okay, what is the greatest cheesy B-movie title that you've seen at, like, you know, like Amoeba Records has all these, you know, horror movie section and,
wait,
and
like title or
title and what the movie was about.
I also want to add to it, what's your favorite cheesy movie?
My favorite?
No, I'm taking your question and I'm adding a tag-along question to it. So
cheesiest
guess
title
first.
Well, you know, as far as favorite cheesiest movie, not that it's cheesy, but I think some people will call it cheesy, but like Evil Dead 2 is
that pinnacle. Yes.
Good choice.
But I feel like some people would watch that and be like, this movie's stupid. Like, you're stupid.
Well, that's not somebody I would want to hang out
exactly,
with.
Exactly, right?
Yeah. No, Evil Dead 2 is definitely probably the second or third movie that pushed me to want to write. I loved Evil Dead.
But 2 is better.
2 is such a superior movie. You create such a amazing... You create a hero out of somebody so simple that Ash was.
I would argue that it's the best sequel superior to the originals outside of Godfather. Because it made it so much completely better that sometimes you even forget about the first one.
Right.
Well, they're pretty much isn't technically 2 just a remake. It's not really a sequel. It's they just said, hey, we'd like you to make that movie again and here's more money.
He was supposed to make a sequel.
Yeah.
And he just took the money and made a better version of Evil Dead. And then the studio basically said, what the hell is this? It's the same movie. Why would he go back? And they slapped the 2 on it. Because people weren't gonna there was no need to make it a third time.
They both have their merits. But
did you see the high school version?
Yes.
The one within the woods?
Within the woods.
Yeah. They made Evil Dead in high school.
Yeah.
Oh, Sam Raimi.
Sam Raimi, Tapper.
Yeah.
Those guys.
And Bruce Campbell and his brother.
I did not like the remake.
Well, it's not a remake.
It's an original movie.
No. The new one.
It's not a remake. They've come out and, like, the studio forced them to call it Evil Dead. It's like how Halloween, the new Halloween, is a sequel to Halloween, even though it's called Halloween.
Right.
Yeah. The new Evil Dead and the director and everyone have come out and said it is not a remake. It's a continuation, which is one of the the car is still there and, and everything is still, you know, active. It's just a continuation with new characters. And now they're shooting the new one, Evil Dead Rise, in New Zealand, right? I think it's in New Zealand.
Right all of it. They shoot everything out there.
Yeah.
Like Ashen versus Evil Dead was out there.
Yeah. Which that was amazing.
Yeah. I loved it. The ending of that, the ending of that is, if it, it is so amazing because I'm such a huge fan of all anything Army of Darkness, Evil Dead. But when they ended it and it's post-apocalyptic, I was just like, this is exactly where I would have taken it. Right. Like, I was like, I'm so invested in this. This is exactly where it needs to go. And then the key looked awesome. The car looked amazing. I was just like, it's ending here? You can't end it here. This is, needs to go on. And it's just so fucking terrible.
When we saw, I took my wife to go see Spider-Man in the theaters when it first came out. It was like 2002. I think we had been together like 10 minutes. And Bruce Campbell comes on the screen as the wrestler, the ring. And I just lost my shit. And I started nerding out, telling her who he was and what he meant to me. And she just was like, that's cute. Can we get back to this movie?
Yeah.
I'm like,
And then, you know.
Did you tell her that it's because she has a vagina that she doesn't know who he is?
Yes.
See, this is why I'm basing, this is why I'm basing my theory that if you have a vagina, you probably don't appreciate Bruce Campbell as a whole.
Well, my wife can't stand the Evil Dead movies. She can't stand
You guys are all looking at me like I'm crazy.
And then, but she loves Bruce Campbell. She loves Bruce Campbell because
they're a Briscoe County Jr. fan.
Oh, no, that's my dad. That show was my dad. Jam, dude.
But no, she loves him from that the Miami show. What was
Burn
Notice. Burn Notice.
Yeah.
And we've seen him talk at conventions a few times, and she just thinks he's incredible. I'm like, Bruce Campbell stopped being Bruce Campbell a long ass time ago, and he is now just Ash Williams forever.
Pretty much, that's it.
You know, I met the real Bruce Campbell like a long, long time ago in college. A friend of mine was working at a special effects studio, and they became email buddies. And he was the guy who ran the theater at CSUN.
Wasn't email when you were in college. You
there was, totally. And
AOL.com.
And then they emailed and he said, oh, I'm showing this Halloween. I'm showing Evil Dead 2 and Army of Darkness. If you get the opportunity to come down, that'd be great. And the guy goes, yeah, sure, I'll come down. And he came down to a theater that had 25 people in it.
Wow.
On a college campus. And then at the end of it, they pulled out a little folding table and he signed everybody's autograph. And he joked through the movie. He talked through the whole entire thing. And as soon as each movie ended, he would say, like, what the fuck is wrong with you? He'd get up and say, this movie's terrible. This movie's terrible. What are you guys doing here? Go out and trick or treat. Go out and have a party. And he was saying, it was fantastic. I don't know if he got the idea to sign autographs for money after that.
Right.
Because it was so early on. That Bruce Campbell doesn't exist. It is Ash Williams in a cheap suit.
That's crazy.
It's crazy.
So I have a question about talking about Bruce Campbell.
Yeah.
Question for you guys. Have we already put together bids on if he's going to show up in Doctor Strange?
I think he's Mephisto.
Wait, what?
That's bold.
I think he's Mephisto.
Why? Why
because Sam Raimi's directing Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
That's right.
And so he's been in pretty much every one of Sam's
movies. Yeah, he'll be in it. But I honestly think he's Mephisto.
No, he'll be a cameo.
Yeah, there's no. He doesn't, I don't think he can carry
that.
He
just does cameos.
No, he totally can.
No.
Totally can.
I don't know.
No way.
Well,
no
way. Okay, so your cheesy movie title or his favorite cheesy movie?
That was my favorite cheesy movie. Cheesy movie title.
Yeah.
Don't be a menace to South Central while drinking your juice in the head.
I mean, that's I saw Ed and His Dead Mother.
There you go.
That's a really bizarre title. Yeah. And a bizarre movie.
Yeah. I saw one that was The Killer Hybrid. It kills and saves the environment at the same time.
Jesus.
Yeah. It's a killer hybrid movie.
Favorite shitty movie? Toxic Avenger.
Yeah, that's cool.
Which they're remaking now. Yeah, it's a big Hollywood blockbuster.
It's supposed to be like Bradley Cooper.
Kevin Bacon is the bad guy.
Kevin Bacon.
Bradley Cooper is the Toxic Avenger.
No, that would be sick.
It's someone famous, though.
Yeah, it is.
No, it's they announced the whole cast.
Is it a troll? It's not a troll.
There's Elijah Wood's in it.
Nice.
It's not. It's. I mean,
he's
sure
not
Boyd's
toxic, is he?
No, I thought it was Peter Dinklage.
Oh yeah, it is
Peter Dinklage. Oh, yeah. All right, sweet.
Wait, Peter Dinklage is the Toxic Avenger?
Yeah,
that's my understanding.
He's a short person.
Short person.
But I mean, I'm sure
maybe
he's going to be
evolves
anime.
Into
yeah,
a,
no, maybe yeah,
it's
maybe
Hollywood, mutates into
yeah.
A
yeah, CGI. Yeah,
the Toxic Avenger is like 7 feet fucking tall.
All right. Well, that is our show this week. Steven, where can people find your work?
You can check out, the website is abysmal.com, which is A-B-Y-S-S-M-A-L.
Two S's, guys.
Two S's.
And are you on the socials?
Yep, and we're on all the TikToks and all that stuff.
He dances on there.
At Abysmal?
You don't look like a pedophile.
Abysmal. Yep, okay. It's all at Abysmal.
Well, we appreciate you coming on. Congratulations on the launch of your...
Yeah, thanks for having me.
I hope it goes the places you want it to go.
Ghostbusters sure. Reanimated.
Reanimated, yep.
Go, go up on YouTube, guys.
Give them a like and a subscribe. If I was you, I'd wanna be me too. I'd wanna be me too. I'd wanna be me too.
Thank you for listening to this week's episode of The Infamous Chronicles. This episode was recorded, produced, and edited live in the Infamous Work Studios in Los Angeles, California. We want to note that all of the statements made in this and all previous episodes are the opinions of the hosts of those episodes and do not in any way, shape, or form reflect fact. We do not carry any copyright use of the music in this episode. We are simply fans of it. If you're interested in contacting us, please email us at info@infamousworks.com with any guest or topic suggestions. And go ahead and give a listen to our sister shows, Weed Wednesdays, Maternal Instincts, Discussing Depression, and Murder of Nerds. Thank you for listening to this week's episode, and we'll see you next time on the Infamous Chronicles.